First of all, thank you so much for the warm invitation that you all extended to me. I'm really very grateful to be a part of this wonderful lecture series. And also thank you so much for introducing me. Unfortunately, because of my own misunderstanding of technical things, I was unable to be present there at that time. But thank you so much once again. So my topic of presentation today is Armchair Narratives: Solidarity, Resilience, and Resurrection in the Time of COVID-19. Now, before I move into the detailed lecture or the detailed part of my lecture, what I like to share with you is that there are like three parts. I have divided my lecture into three parts. And what I have really planned out is that I'll be reflecting, sharing my thoughts for the next kind of 35-40 minutes. And then we can have a collaborative discussion, a collective reflection. And then like you can pose me questions or you can share your thoughts or whatever way you want to, interact with me. Just feel free to do that. Now, I'm going to divide my lecture into three parts. So the first part, what I'm going to say is, or trying to share with you is that, what do I mean by armchair narratives at all? And why, as an individual, with respect to my experiences, I think it is important to be a part of such narratives in our daily life, in spite of our busy schedule, in spite of our all kinds of engagements that we have in our personal as well as in our professional life. Why is it important for us to be a part of this exercise, which I call a kind of collaborative, co-creative, collective exercise, this being a part of armchair narratives? The second part of my lecture is what I have titled as Ghorwa Adda. It's a Bengali term. Those who are Bengalis here will be able to understand, but for those who are not familiar with the Bengali language, for sure I'll try my best to roughly translate this particular term, Ghorwa Adda. And my second part is Ghorwa Adda, ethics, aesthetics, and phenomenology. What is actually Ghorwa Adda? Why is it important? Why do we need to come together and sit together and share our thoughts with each other? It's not just, it's not just a verbal exercise or it's not just a physical exercise, but it's much beyond that. So what is it all about? I'm going to talk that about in part two. And especially in context with this scenario of COVID-19, where some of us are happy to be with our parents, our relatives, or our people at home. But for some, it's a kind of forceful reunion with the family. So we are having multiple forms of experiences with respect to it. And the third part, which is going to be the concluding part of the lecture, I'm going to talk about is solidarity, resilience, and resurrection during COVID-19. So what kind of solidarities? What kind of resilience? And what kind of resurrections I am talking about? That will be my third part of the lecture. Now, going to the very first part of the lecture. Now, you see this term armchair in case of literature, in case of theory, theoretical and philosophical arguments, usually what we see is that the term armchair is not used in a very positive connotation, right? Like, for instance, we often say armchair activism. We say armchair theories. We say armchair media. So we don't use it in the very positive sense. It's mostly used in the perspective of, critiquing somebody that who just, instead of acting practically, just sits back in a very comfort zone and criticize different ideologies, different individuals, different perspectives without actively participating in a particular scenario. So that kind of, scenario, that kind of phenomenon, usually we term as armchair, right? So armchair is usually in a negative sense. Here, what I'm using is, I am using this armchair in a positive sense, and obviously in a totally different context. So I thought this justification is required at the very beginning of my reflections. Otherwise, people might be confused that why I am talking about armchair narratives or why exactly I'm trying to appreciate it or why I'm trying to, present it in a very positive manner. So this is the first thing that I wanted to share with you all, that what do I mean by armchair narrative is it's a completely different context. So what is my context? Now the question is, what is my context of reflection? See, basically, we know what is a, if we take the physical object, armchair, many of us in our houses, we have armchairs made of wood, made of plastic or whatever. In the ancient times, maybe when I say about the ancient times, maybe at the time of our parents or vastly of our grandparents, or more importantly of our great-grandparents, we used to have something in the Bengali households, which is a very common, but that is not actually a Bengali furniture. It came from the Anglo-Indians to us, from the British, then through the Anglo-Indians, and then it came to the Bengali household. We refer to it as the aram kedara. So you have this long handles, you know, you sit, you lay back, and it's very comfortable. You know, you have long handles, you lay back, you sit there and you relax. It's a relaxing, even it's so slanting and so comfortable that if after you know, a delicious lunch meal, you just lay back and, you know, you take rest. It's a very comfort zone, actually, both eternally and physically as well. So, you know, that is this armchair, this where this element of armchair has a multiple significance in the life of an individual, especially who are coming specifically from Bengali culture. Not necessarily it was a part of the Bengali culture, though it was common among the Bengali households, but it was seen in other households as well across the country, India. So what happens is this armchair is not just a physical object. Obviously, it's a physical object. It's a physical object of comfort. It's a physical object of feeling, being homely. It's a physical object of where one can take rest. One can throw away all the tensions and all the burdens of existence and sit there and relax. That's obviously one thing. But apart from the armchair being a physical object, armchair also functions as a very strong cultural component as well. Because, you know, in today's house, we have so many modern day furnitures, locally made as well as imported furnitures we all have based on our respective financial status or whatever. But what is happening is in those times, like in the times of our parents, our grandparents or our great grandparents, what we used to see is that this armchair just not functioned as a physical object, but also as a cultural object, as an object through which, you know, different members from different parts of the particular family or parts of the relatives or parts of the particular household will come together, sit together, sit on those armchairs, interact with each other, reflect on their respective thoughts, reflect on their respective memories, etc., etc. So it's a strong cultural object as well, because it represents a particular community's culture. It represents a particular community's cultural practice as well. So that armchair is a very important cultural object as well. Thirdly, it's a fantastic historical object, obviously, because today, as I, you know, mentioned the term called aram kedara, that is with long, you know, arm keepers, very long hands where you can keep, wooden hands where you can keep your arms and rest back and lay comfortably. It's a very interesting historical object. Like, you know, in most of the households, you don't find it exists today because that has been replaced by either they have been sold off. Some of the households who are very, you know, concerned about their historical objects, who are very interested in collecting and preserving historical objects, they often keep it, but mostly as a showpiece, not for regular usage, because due to lack of maintenance, it might have withered away. But it functions as a very strong historical component as well. That is where you sit back, but you just don't sit back. You sit back to, you know, create a space for yourself, create an existential, both physical and psychological existential space for yourself where the past and the present, you know, amalgamates with each other. So, you know, this is a kind of exercise, you know, armchair narrative is a kind of exercise. So before I go into the question of narrative, I am trying to give a holistic dimension of the symbol of an armchair in everybody's life, what it could be or what it had been till today. So the historical objects, it functions as a very strong historical space where one sits there, one's past and the present amalgamates with each other. It reconfigurates, it recreates the historical significance of that particular object. And the historical significance of the particular object is obviously related, can be valued to that collective environment. So when I look at an object, when I look at the historical significance and object, obviously I don't understand or analyze that object with respect to only that object. I also see around the surroundings. I also look for other objects, living and non-living, that are connected to that particular object. So obviously this armchair as a historical object is both a singular and collective object. Then obviously it functions, once we talk about history, so automatically memories come into the question. So it functions as a mnemonic object as well. An object that kind of, you know, helps us to recover our past memories in context with the present. So the next, obviously, then it functions as a very emotional object as well. When we get nostalgic about our past, and you know, this question of nostalgia is especially significant in the time of COVID-19 because we see everywhere. I mean, very simple examples is, simple examples are when you just go onto the social networking sites like Facebook and all, people are posting photos a year back. So this day in 2009, I was here, such wonderful days. We don't know when those days will come back. Nostalgia. 3 years back, pre-COVID days, no restrictions, no quarantining, no lockdowns, such wonderful days. We don't know when those days are come back. So, you know, this nostalgic element is a part and parcel of our daily existence. We can't live without it. I mean, how much we try to talk of practicality, how much theoretically or, practically we try to justify that we have to overcome nostalgia, nostalgia can have a negative impact, etc., etc. But you see, in real life, in our daily life, this nostalgia plays a pivotal role, a very strong role in terms of emotional objectives as well. So this element of emotional object. So when we just have this armchair, it's not just a physical object. It's not just a cultural object. It is a historical object. It's a mnemonic object. It is recovering and relieving my memories. At the same time, it is also a form of emotional object when I can recollect and recover some sets of memories which are present within certain specific dimensions of time and space. So for instance, when I go back to my home, the Aram Kedara that we had at Kolkata's home now have been shifted to our sister's home in Delhi. So when I visit my sister at Delhi, when I sit back in that Aram Kedara and I sit and I look straight, you know, so many interplay of emotions take place. It makes me think about my grandparents. It makes me think about that once upon a time when I was a kid, my grandfather will sit here and he will narrate, you know, children's stories to me. He will narrate stories from his childhood days. This is the place where my dad will sit and he will narrate stories about his great grandmother, his grandmother. And then, you know, so you see, you know, it plays so many different types of roles. It has so many wonderful roles to play, this particular one object, armchair. Now, coming to the question of narrative. So now what I spoke about is the various dimensions of armchair as a physical object, not only as a physical object, but also as a cultural, historical, memory and emotional object. How do I understand this element of armchair? Okay, number one. Now, coming now to the question of narratives. So what do I mean by armchair narratives? So you see, now coming to the question of narratives, when we talk about the notion of narrative, is now once we understand this, the different dimensions and the valuability of armchair, now the question comes, how do we express it? Now those different ways and perspectives of our expression, whether it's verbal, whether it's physical, whether it's written, whether it's emotional, all these are a part of our narrative. So when we talk about these elements of narratives, we talk about the different physical and the psychological things that comes to the forefront. And what I believe is that this armchair, this contribution of armchair in our daily life is once it enables us to recover all these different types of objectives of this particular physical object, the different types of objectives that gets recovered in the process, actually kind of enable us to indulge ourselves in a form of narrative, in a form of exchange. And at the same time, I believe personally that, you know, this is a very strong and very crucial form of cultural exchange and cultural narrative altogether. Because what is happening is in the present day, what we see that you know, with the arrival of, you know, so much of reckless capitalistic desires that we actually, you know, have within us in our day-to-day life, our life consistently going into the direction of materialistic ways of existence, giving up all the rest of the, everything is being weighed and measured and transacted materialistically, even human emotions as well. In such a kind of scenario, you know, the armchair narratives, relieving, recreating, and practicing armchair narratives is very important. You know, from the spiritual dimensions, you know, spiritualists, psychologists, physiologists, and doctors, and so on and so forth, they say us that, you know, at the end of every day, no matter how much we are busy, how much we are engaged with our daily life, it is extremely important for all of us to engage ourselves. It is extremely important for all of us to sit back and think that what did we do? What did we talk? What did we learn? What did we think throughout the day? But the question is, amidst our extremely busy schedules, how many of us in our daily life, no matter in whichever profession we are indulged in, no matter whatever we are doing, how many of us are able to do it? How many of us are able to engage with these kind of thought process or exercises? So here again, in such a kind of crisis, in such a kind of existential crisis that we exist, it's a physical existential crisis, it's a psychological existential crisis as well. So in such a kind of crisis, armchair narratives function as a kind of, you know, it's a kind of exercise, I believe. Armchair narratives function as a kind of process, as a kind of phenomenon, as a kind of aesthetical practice through which we can sit back together, collectively engage and share with each other. Now, what happens is, even as academicians, as researchers, our main problem is, instead of, you know, knowledge sharers, instead of concentrating on knowledge dissemination, usually what we are trying to do is we are trying to become producers of knowledge. Now, once we, you know, we talk about knowledge production, but how many of us are, and we are indulging in knowledge production, but how many of us are sincerely indulging in the process of knowledge dissemination? And this exercise of dissemination indulges a process of sharing with each other. It's not just a one-way narrative. It's not just a one-way narrative. That's why at the very beginning of my reflection, I say to you that I'm going to stop at 35, 40 minutes and then open up for questions, reflections, agreements, and disagreements. Because that is the way where how we can learn and unlearn with and from each other, and also share our thoughts with each other. Okay, whatever I have in mind, I am sharing with you right now. After you listen to me, many thoughts must be going across your mind. You might agree with me, disagree with me, criticize me, appreciate me, whatever. But there is always, you know, it is very important for us to generate that depolarized plural space for exchanges with each other. So it shouldn't be a one-way narrative. So, you know, again, this armchair narratives where we are all sitting, just imagine a scenario that one fine evening, you along with your grandparents, parents, relatives, siblings, friends, you're just sitting out in an open drawing room and you're just chatting, talking, you know, snacking on something, laughing, you know, even fighting with each other, but you are sharing your thoughts with each other. How many of us, you know, are able to do this in today's world on a regular basis? On a regular basis, leave it aside. Even sometimes, how many of us are able to do it? You know, people are found that they are sitting in drawing room and, you know, somewhere in the sitting room and bedroom, and they are talking to each other over WhatsApp and phone. So this is our condition. This is how we have mechanized ourselves, how we have converted ourselves into machines. So in such a scenario, I believe that COVID-19, obviously there are various positive and negative aspects. For everybody, staying back at home is not at all a great experience for various personal, private, and public reasons. I completely understand that, but I'm trying to focus that there is a, or I'm trying to, you know, direct you or drive you towards the direction of positivity through this particular reflection, that lot of positive dimensions also have come up. And that is, many people who are sharing that it's been like 4 years, I have not visited my home, but it is because of this COVID-19 lockdown that I could go back to my home. I could spend time with my parents, my siblings, my relatives, my friends, my neighborhood. So you see, this collective environment that COVID-19 has also pushed us towards a collective space of learning, sharing, and understanding with each other, which is an integral part of the armchair narrative. So we are all sitting together, imagine a situation, or maybe many of you must be experiencing this, sitting together in armchairs, talking, interacting, you know, and, you know, sharing one's thoughts with each other. So that is what is basically a kind of gharwa adda. Okay, what I have been talking about. So if you see, I mean, gharwa adda is a term which is very ambivalent in nature and it can have multiple forms of translations. So obviously I'm not going to go into that, you know, that trap that you see, this is the only translation of gharwa adda. So I have mentioned that, it can be roughly translated as a familial get together in a homely environment, or you are just simply what I've been talking about, that we are all sitting in a, in a drawing room together and, we are just talking, interacting and arguing and sharing our thoughts with each other. Now, if you remember, I titled my part two as Ethics, Aesthetics and Phenomenology. Three crucial components. So you see, usually, if we look into again, once again, we go back, we travel back to the time of our stories of our parents, of our grandparents, of our great grandparents. What we usually see is that there was a typical, every family has its own traditions. Every family has its own ethics of existence, which obviously differs from families to families, communities to communities, religious to religions, etc., races to races, and so many dimensions are there. Now, this gharwa adda actually brings forth those rich, traditional, indigenous, valuable ethics, which we have been inheriting from our forefathers and foremothers in the process of our existence into practice. Now, what is happening is there was a point of time when, joint family system was the norm. In today's world, it has become a rare phenomenon. Now, even people downplay the concept of joint family system as something backward and very unmodern and kind of primitive, so on and so forth. It is adjectivized in a negative manner from so many dimensions. But still, there were one positive, like there are every positive and negative element about all kinds of existence. So one positive element about this joint family, among several, one positive element was that the joint family system, not on all occasions, but on several occasions, it gave an individual a space to learn from and with each other. So there was no such divisions that one has to learn from this particular person, one has to learn from this particular institution. So in other words, the compartments of existence, the different compartments of ethics and moralities and, the kind of binaries, of good and bad, right and wrong, moral, immoral, positive, negative, all these kind of binaries that exist within the ethics and the aesthetics of the nuclear family existence, that was not so prominent at the time of the joint family system. Because, there was a kind of, yes, there were patriarchal hierarchies, there were hierarchies in terms of age groups, there were hierarchies in terms of gender and so on and so forth. But at the same time, the process of learning and sharing was a very collaborative and co-creative one. So that particular process of learning and sharing, where there was this always a scope of knowledge dissemination in a familial get-together, in a familial environment, there is always a process of knowledge dissemination where we are not just imposing our thoughts and actions on some individuals. What we are doing is we are learning and sharing with each other. So this process, of learning and sharing with each other is missing today. That's why, you see, there is so much of epistemic intolerance amongst ourselves. For instance, if I say something, if you don't agree with me, what I'll do is if I am more powerful physically, politically, I'll try to overpower you, or vice versa. So there is always an intolerance. Whatever a narrative is generated by an individual or a collective group, it is expected by that individual or that particular collective group that it will be accepted holistically by everybody. If someone comes up with something else which goes against the principles of that particular individual or a collective group, ultimately what happens is it really leads to intolerance and at the same time subjugating each other's voices. So, you know, this exercise of knowledge dissemination instead of knowledge production, instead of the capitalistic exercise of knowledge production, we need to indulge ourselves in the process of knowledge dissemination. And this process of knowledge dissemination is actually an important component. One important exercise of a part of it is we agree to disagree with each other. And that actually familial togetherness, sitting in a same space, that is what I was talking about, depolarized plural space. Sitting in the same space, people from different age groups, people from different generations, people from different cultures, different traditions, different time, different space, coming together in the same space and interacting with each other. This exercise is very, very important in our regular life. And the first institution that teaches us this exercise is always our family. I remember in my childhood days, if I give some examples from my life, in my childhood days, in evening time, there will be one point of time where for 15 minutes, 20 minutes, or even 30 minutes, we will all sit together and talk to each other. Now, this exercise is very important because the process is that we learn to agree to disagree with each other. We learn how to create solidarities. We learn how to generate a de-hierarchical space. We learn how to tolerate each other. We learn how to compromise with each other. These are the basic ethics of existence. These are the basic elements of existence which we are completely living without today. That's why what is happening is, you know, frustrations, psychological disturbances. There are various other reasons for those, but these are one of the reasons that we have lost these basic ethics. No matter how much theory and how much philosophy and how much collective reflection, etc., we talk about, but it can't be denied, this particular fact can't be denied, that these basic ethics of collective and co-creative existence is completely missing. So that is why I am talking about that this COVID-19, what it has done for many families, I'm not generalizing or I'm not trying to stereotype generally. For many families, this Gharwa Adda, this phenomenon of Gharwa Adda, or this phenomenology of Gharwa Adda, has actually recreated the ethics and the aesthetics of basic values of our existence. And that is through we are able to do family, friends, relatives, different generations of people, stories from different generations, memories. Now, those things can be expressed in agreement with each other, in disagreement with each other, in conflict with each other. But you know, these are very important. Conflicts in life is very important. If for every yes, all of us say yes, if for every no, all of us say no, that's not the purpose, real purpose of, you know, knowledge creation or knowledge dissemination or epistemic existence. We need to disagree with each other, but at the same time, respecting each other's disagreements. Instead of condemning it, instead of dehumanizing it, instead of subalternizing it or silencing it, it is extremely important for all of us, you know, to agree to disagree with each other. And how that is possible? Through intermingling and exchanges. And those exchanges, as already, you know, briefly discussed in part one, that those exchanges basically take place how? It takes place emotionally, it takes place culturally, it takes place intergenerationally, historically, geographically, and so on and so forth. Let me tell you, like, for instance, I personally, I'm a kind of a food aholic. I like to eat a lot. And at the same time, I have a knack for, you know, getting the taste, imbibing the taste of different types of food from different parts of my state, my country, across the world. So many of the food items that I have come to know today, It's just through this process of gharwa adda. I did not read on Google. I did not read anything, recipe books on Facebook, ebooks, or any books I purchased from the shop. No, I did not do that. Just sitting in with respect to my elders in my family, what happens is I learned a lot of food items, the historical background of these food items. How did they come to existence? Why certain food items were prohibited in particular households? Why certain food items were preferred more than others? So many dimensions just I came to know through this process of gharwa adda. And this process of, coming together, different generations sitting towards each other, also at the end, last but not the least, enables us to develop a mutual respect towards each other. We remain rooted to our own cultures and traditions. Unfortunately, in today's world, what is happening, we are so much indulged in this blind rat game of mimicking from others, mimicking from the West, mimicking from the other parts of the world, and forgetting our own cultural roots and traditions. What it is leading is in a kind of decapitated state, which actually, you must have read Gugi Wa Thiong'o. He talks about physical decapitation. Then there is Eviatar Zerubbabel. He talks about mnemonic decapitation. So we are getting decapitated physically, psychologically, mnemonically. We are just getting separated from our roots. Our attachment to our roots are just being chopped off. So we don't exist anywhere. We are just existing in the middle. That is what is actually leading us or forcing us towards such issues or such problems of massive problems of existential crisis. So gharwa adda in the time of COVID-19 is a kind of strong weapon for many families, for many individuals to come out of this crisis, or at least to fight this crisis in a constructive manner. Now, having given this background of armchair, symbolical representation of armchair, its narratives, what are armchair narratives, how it is associated with the notion of gharwa adda, how gharwa adda is an ethical, aesthetical, and phenomenological perspective. Having talked about briefly about these components, what I'm going to talk about is I'm going to come to the third part of my reflection. And as I said to you, there are three components. One is solidarities, one is resilience, one is resurrection. So now what kind of solidarities it is creating in the process? Now the first is, as we have been talking about familial togetherness, obviously those who ourselves, we are indulging ourselves back. We are meeting our parents, our grandparents, our relatives, our friends, after a long period of time sitting together, interacting with each other, talking to each other, learning with and from each other, unlearning with and from each other. It is generating familial solidarities. And in today's world, we see that broken families have become a common phenomenon. And obviously, there are ample of reasons. But amongst those ample of reasons, we can't deny the fact that one particular reason is our mechanical / capitalistic modes of existence, where our entire versions of existence, entire forms of existence, entire ways of expressing each other are totally centered on machines, whether it's a mobile phone or a laptop or various forms of applications, etc. So what is happening is those natural spontaneous emotional connectivities are withering away. So that is kind of, getting back into shape for many people in the time of COVID-19. Second is cultural solidarities. Obviously, now they're all interconnected with each other. So now once we have this familial solidarities, what we have is we are able to know each other more clearly. Everything cannot be understood in the written form. Reading a few research articles, storybooks, watching a few movies or videos doesn't complete our parameter of knowledge gaining. A lot of knowledges just remain as oral narratives. We need to imbibe those. We need to document those. You know, so cultural solidarities. And many of you, I don't know if you are working with the field of partition novels. Many of you must be interested in working with the field of, you know, of refugee studies and all. So you must be very much aware of the fact that how oral narratives plays a pivotal role in your research. Many of the things you won't just see, you won't see exist in the books, but you come to know about it just through interacting with people. So cultural solidarities. And remember this term solidarity, which I should have said you prior to this, you know, mentioning these two points, that this term solidarity has a both positive and negative connotation. Solidarity can be inclusive as well as exclusive as well. So the simple thing is, you know, I can talk about solidarities, but in the process, what can happen is I might exclude certain ideologies, certain perspectives, certain thoughts. So what I'm basically reflecting or trying to reflect here is de-hierarchical solidarity. So familial solidarities, cultural solidarities, social solidarities, and then obviously emotional solidarities. I mean, which is very important because, you know, these four points are intertwined with each other. Where emotionally we feel for each other. Emotionally, we express ourselves for each other. Emotionally, we live for each other. Instead of just living for my own self and something is happening, or instead of just, you know, suffocating myself within that false box of bad faith, false box of Saturn bad faith, where we think that, okay, I am happy means the world is happy. I am sad means the world is sad. So it is important for us to, you know, overcome this bad faith, this selfish, self-centered modes of existence. That I-ness defines or this very attitude of defining the world with respect to I-ness should be thrown away right now. And this exercise, you know, of Ghorwa Adda, sitting together, armchair narratives, enables us to disentangle from such suffocating, self-centered, narrow-bordered platforms. So emotional solidarities, social solidarities, cultural solidarities, and familial solidarities in the process. And they're all interconnected with each other. Now, coming to the question of resilience, and we were talking about this question of, you know, adjusting, learning to adjust with each other, learning to compromise with each other, learning to respect each other's spaces. To talk about that and to, you know, argue that in a critical manner, I have presented you four concepts from four different parts of the world. Afro-Caribbean philosopher, Professor Lewis Gordon, in many of his articles, he often talks about this notion of, argues with this notion of relationality. How do we define this notion of relationality? It can be defined from multiple dimensions. It can be very hierarchical. It can be very exclusive. It can be that only some relationships are only identified as authentic relationships. Rest of the relationships are inauthentic relationships. And we all know, from gender perspective, political perspective, you know, social perspective, religious perspective, racial perspective, it happens. So to overcome these hierarchies, these, you know, pseudo-logical, unscientific binaries that has come to existence in our life today, it is important to make a paradigmatic shift from eliminations to connections. That is where we all are able to connect to each other. And just imagine once again the things that I have been sharing with you with respect to Ghorwa Adda and all, that how we can all connect to each other. Now, connection doesn't mean that we are all, you know, agreeing with each other. Connection can be disagreement also. Connection can be that you don't agree at all with each other. But in return of that, you have your own constructive arguments. In the process of disagreement, you don't dehumanize me. In the process of disagreement, I don't reject you. I respect you. I respect your points. I appreciate. But I don't accept. That's perfectly fine. And that is how we develop connections with each other. Second point is motofatso. Motofatso is actually in the Sesotho language. Sesotho, now again, this very to be very brief. This Sesotho language is the national language of an African country a country in Africa called Lesotho, widely spoken there. And also a major population in the country of South Africa also speaks this language called what I mentioned right now. So this Mothofatso, the simple term Mothofatso means rehumanization. And there is a very, you know, very respected, very revered South African philosopher. He is currently as a professor in the University of South Africa. His name is Mogobo P. Ramose. Professor Ramose often talks about this element of Mothofatso. Mothofatso as an indigenous way of collective and co-creative existence. Now, we have been in the process, consciously or unconsciously, when we reject each other's terms, we just don't reject each other. We just don't silence each other. What we happen is we also insult each other's humanitarian values. In other terms, we try to dehumanize each other. So we have to refrain from that, you know, negative exercise of dehumanization and indulge ourselves in rehumanization. And once again, you know, armchair narratives, you know, enables us to know each other closely, enables instead of living with preconceived notions, living with some prejudices, we are able to know each other closely through this process of interacting with each other. So this exercise of armchair narrative is also an exercise of Mothofatso. Third is Ubuntu. Now, this is a very common term. I am pretty sure the meaning of Ubuntu, it keeps on circulating in WhatsApp, Facebook, and so many books you find. Ubuntu is commonly in the African continent. Ubuntu is a very common way of existence amongst the indigenous tribal communities of Africa, widely in the African continent. So the term Ubuntu is often used by decolonial philosophers and indigenous scholars in the continent of Africa as a counter argument to the Descartesian notion of I think, therefore I am. So Ubuntu as a counter argument says I am because we are. That is again this indigenous practice of collective and co-creative existence. And I am because we are is an exercise, also a powerful exercise, through which we can overcome and come out all forms of bad faith. That is, I am because I am, or I think I, so if you talk even about the Descartesian existence, it is also a form of bad faith. So if you look into this notion of I am because we are, it pushes us into a collective space of existence where again, we learn how to exist with and from each other. And the last part of the resilience that I talk about is a concept, existential concept, as followed by a Mexican, a local indigenous Mexican tribal community referred to as the Guna people. The Guna people, I have italicized that. The Guna people in their community, they have this Guna language. In Guna language, there is this term called Abya Yala. Now, Abya Yala is not just a term, it's not just a phrase, but it's a phenomenon, it's a concept. And it means that an indigenous native space in its full maturity. And they believe that the indigenous native space can be in its full maturity when we respect each and every thread of our existence. They believe that their origin from their forefathers and foremothers to the present day is like the umbilical cord of the child. It is connected to the mother's womb. They believe in a similar manner, their blood is connected to their mother. Their mother is their land. Their blood is connected to their motherland through an invisible umbilical cord, which they must keep on respecting, because that umbilical cord was developed by their forefathers, that symbolical umbilical cord, that thread, they are all connected to each other. That connection should be respected. And when I was arguing that when in a drawing room, people from different generations, from different age groups, from different time, space, culture, geography come together and sit, you know, that umbilical, that missing umbilical cord is regenerated. We are all connected to each other, maybe in difference, maybe in togetherness, but we are all connected to each other. So you see, this is how resilience is created through armchair narratives. And the last part is obviously resurrection. Now, having said that, obviously, now you will be able to understand what are the different types of resurrections that can take place in the process. One is obviously the traditional cultural resurrection that is taking place in the process, which is very, very important. That is when we are people from different generations, people from different age groups are coming up, different cultures, different traditions, different memories, different lifestyles, different histories are all coming in the same platform. They're interplaying and interacting with each other. So a traditional cultural form of resurrection, it's a mnemonic resurrection. Memories from different generations are coming on the same platform, interacting with each other, intermingling with each other. So memories from different directions, with different dimensions are coming together. Physical resurrection, that is when we, if we just talk about that physical space of the drawing room, people sitting in their armchairs in different age groups, all circling about each other in different corners of the room, it actually recreates or regenerates that umbilical cord of the family. It indulges or provokes people to indulge in an exercise of abhyayala. And the last one, obviously not the least one, but the last one in my presentation is a psychological resurrection, where in case of psychological resurrection, we through this process of traditional cultural resurrection, mnemonic resurrection, physical resurrection, gradually our mind, our body that has been, you know, that till date that has been rotting in all the mechanical dimensions and the machinated ways of existence gradually recovers into the spontaneities of daily life. A daily life of togetherness, of collaboration, of co-creation, of polylogues, of agreements and disagreements. And so I'll stop here and thank you so much once again for your patience and listening to me. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir, on behalf of Govindaprasad Mahavidyalaya. So we'll just go through the chat box and see if some questions are there.
Yes, sure.
I would like to request Bishwajit to carry on with the interactive session. Bishwajit, over to you.
Thank you, ma'am, for giving me the chance to interact with Dr. Shahinde. Okay, I will request all the participants to put up your questions on the chat box. And sure, if you please allow me, I can read out the questions for you from the chat box.
Yes, please, please, please.
Okay, and there is an also announcement for the participants. If you can, or if you wish to interact with Dr. Shahinde, you can unmute yourself and put up your observation or questions or interaction with sure. Okay, sir, as I can see, there is one question from Benazir Sheikh. That is, there is an observation first. So, Gharwa Adda, in the context of COVID-19 situation, looks at the positive aspects. But there has been a considerable surge in case of domestic violence, as well as how is Gharwa Adda is the only outlook?
So, okay, yes. Thank you so much, Benazir, for this interesting question. So first of all, you are very much right. And also this point I mentioned at the very beginning that, you know, coming together for some people is a great leisurely time. But also for some people, it's a matter of being forcefully united with one's family. Let me tell you at the very outset that when I presented my reflection here with respect to Gharwa Adda, I also mentioned categorically that we have both negative and positive impact of COVID-19. So what I'm doing through this particular set of reflection is I am exclusively focusing on the positive impact of COVID-19. So my point of Gharwa Adda is not about the perspective that Gharwa Adda is the only solution, or Gharwa Adda or coming together in a homely environment is the only process. through which we can overcome all the problems. I say it, what I'm through this perspective of Ghoro Adda, what I'm trying to point out or what I'm trying to reflect is that amongst the various positive things that we can draw from this lockdown of COVID-19, one aspect is Ghoro Adda. So Ghoro Adda is never the only outlook. And even I have not talked about it or mentioned about it that it is the only outlook that is there existing. It is one of those positive outlooks. So first thing is my focus was on the positive outlook, question of positive outlook. And the second point is that this Ghoro Adda is one of those components of positive outlook. That's it.
Thank you, sir. I think there is there is another observation by Bhumita Mondal, and also question is also there. Her question is, sir, firstly, a flood of thanks for your wonderful deliberation. So in this digital era, we are getting so much absorbed in digital gadgets that we left no time for our family. So I want to know that does this lack of Ghoro Adda lead to our lives to a distressed state? This is the question. And I mean, at present time, there are lots of suicide cases. If you please throw some light upon that case, please, sir.
Yes, Momita, thank you for this very interesting question. First of all, I express my sincere gratitude for your kind words of appreciation. Now, coming to your question, I personally believe that Ghoro Addas are one of the major reasons that we are all failing to realize in the process of interacting with each other. And that is kind of creating a distressed state within us. Because you see, physical gadgets, whatever it is, whether electronic gadgets, gadgets for beautification, gadgets for whatever, as dresses or whatever we do, each and every form of the physical gadget has its limited life. Once it's over, we throw it away. We get a new one. So that insatiating mechanical thirst for mechanical things will never end. But Ghoro Adda, as I mentioned, it's an emotional exercise, cultural exercise, social exercise, and it's a collective exercise. So obviously, I mean, loneliness is one of the reasons that has been aggravating the causes of suicide today. And it's been for a long time. With this lockdown, it has aggravated further. And this cause of loneliness, one major reason is obviously our failure to interact with each other. And that is actually leading to various other problems. That is leading to misunderstandings. That is leading to, conflicts. That is leading to ego problems, egocentric conflicts amongst each other. Lot of simple elements, turns complicated because we fail to interact with each other. Everything is now, packaged in the form of smileys. How to cry, how to laugh, how to smile, how to express our love. Everything is packaged in the smileys. So obviously that normal spontaneous ways of expression, is getting gradually missing, is actually gradually missing right now. So obviously I believe that Ghoro Addas are one of the major reasons, the lack of Ghoro Addas are one of the major reasons why we are unable to, why we are pushing ourselves into such issues of extreme distress and frustrations.
Thank you, sir. Rightly put. There is no other question, sir. Okay, so there is a question by Sarbani Mara, ma'am. This is an observation also. Sir Sarbani Mara, ma'am, Faculty Department of English, Govinda Prasad Mahavidyalaya. So her question is that, sir, you say armchair narratives talk of solidarity. Don't you think that these narratives are limited to only similar social and cultural gaps, the cultural groups, and the concept of solidarity is not extended to the poor and the proletariats who do not have the luxury of armchair discussion? Sure.
Okay, thank you, Sharbani, for this very you know, interesting question, I must say. My answer is both yes and no. My answer is yes, because you're right. To a vast extent, it is limited. It is kind of restricted within similar social and cultural groups who have the privilege to overcome, to be away from problems like poverty, to be away from the different forms of existential crisis of daily life, and you know, engage in kind of these kind of exercises of armchair narratives. So obviously, yes, in that condition, but no is because for many people, we are failing, even amongst the privileged communities, we are failing to understand, many privileged community people are failing to understand the importance of coming together and sharing and exchanging with each other. In spite of the fact that there are privileged people, in spite of the fact that the people have no problem or no tension with their regular crisis or habitual crisis like poverty or any other problem that a poor person might face, or what you mentioned as the extended to the poor. So even if they're not facing these problems, they have given up, they have been so much indulged or, you know, kind of intertwined in the cobweb of this mechanics of existence, that what is happening is they are forgetting these basic ethics and aesthetics of togetherness and co-creation in their real life. So I have an answer for both yes and no for the same reason.
Thank you, sir. There is another observation by Omita Mondol. She first thanks you so much for your thought-provoking lecture. And then she remarks, and I think armchair narratives or gharwa adda very much important for we people, because human being is known as social creature, and social solidarities and emotional solidarities are very much needed for us for a better living and better understanding.
Yes, so, absolutely, Amita. I totally agree with you, because I mean, to whatever extent it is possible, we should come together for these, you know, togetherness, for these gharwa addas, because I mean, keeping in point the previous person who actually Sharbani's question, very very thought-provoking and very interestingly, she pointed this point out, that if we have the scope, so if we have the scope of coming together, we must, you know, find out some time from our daily timetable to come together and interact and talk with each other freely by keeping aside all our daily engagements. So it's very, very important for all of us.
Okay, thank you, sir. There is another question by Sharbani ma'am. That's so, if you could please state some examples of armchair narratives for our students.
Well, armchair narratives, I think in the college life, it's a very common thing. I mean, armchair narratives can be anything. It can be done in any way. I mean, for instance, you know, after the class, it's a common scene. Even our college time also, we will just sit in the classroom in groups and talk to each other, you know, just tease each other, have fun with each other. It's not necessary for us to, you know, sit together and, you know, talk about studies or question papers or what is going to come in the examination. No, but just, you know, relaxed talking. It's just relaxed talking. Even as a graduation student, it was not long time back. I mean, I graduated back in 2011, or I did my post-graduation in 2013. Even during that time, I remember that after every class, we will just simply sit in the class or walk out in the and hang out in the corridor with our friends and all, until unless the next teacher would step in the class, we'll have a gap of 5 to 10 minutes. We will sit out, we will laugh, we will talk, we will joke with each other, we will tease each other. Just this is a kind of a spontaneous relieving exercise, relieving from, you know, at every point of time, we are burdened with our responsibilities. As a student, we think of, we have so many examinations. As a worker, we think of, we have so many responsibilities. If we are family people, we think of, we have to take care of so many people. So burden, if we call it as a burden, the responsibility is always there with us. But the problem, but the point and the question is,
how to overcome that. And through these elements of, you know, coming together and sitting together, interacting, talking and laughing with each other, instead of now the trend, what I find is immediately the class is over, students are going out, you know, immediately walking out of the class and, you know, immediately getting engaged in the phone, either talking on the phone or sending voice messages or, you know, doing, you know, typing on the phone to each other. So this mechanical, this machinated way of existence right now is causing a lot of problems. Even if two friends are sitting beside each other, they're not even talking to each other. They're physically close to each other, but they're just engaged in each other's phone. So this kind of things we need to be careful about right now. It's time that we come together and we recover and relieve those, you know, spontaneous ways of interaction with each other, instead of just binding ourselves, you know, suffocating ourselves within those narrow compartments of machinated ways of life.